A very good morning and welcome to the 22nd meeting of the Criminal Justice Committee in 2023. We have apologies this morning from Katie Clark, and our first item of business is to welcome Sharon Dowie to her first formal meeting of the committee, and I look forward to working with her. So let me now invite Sharon to declare any interests that are relevant to the remit of the Criminal Justice Committee.
Thank you. My husband is a retired police officer, but other than that, I've got nothing to do.
Thanks very much. And can I also refer members to my register of interests in relation to agenda item 7, our approach to the Police Ethics, Conduct and Scrutiny Scotland Bill, which we will discuss later on today, albeit in private. I am a former police officer. So our next item of business is to decide whether to take items 6 and 7 in private. Are we all agreed? Agreed. Thank you. So our next item of business is to review the progress being made to improve the response to deaths in custody. And we're joined today by Jill Emery, who was the chair of the independent review of the response to deaths in prison custody. So welcome, Jill. So I refer members to paper 2, which provides some background on Jill's work and contains a short summary setting out her views on progress made to respond to the recommendations contained in the review. So I intend to run the session for about 60 minutes, although we do have a little bit of time in hand this morning. So I'm now going to invite Jill to make a short opening statement.
Thank you. Good morning. And thank you, convener, and all members of the committee for your ongoing interest in this work. As you know, the independent review was published back in November 2021, and I was appointed the external chair in April last year, 2022, to oversee the progress in implementation of the recommendations of that review. I really want to take this short moment to highlight the contribution made by families to this work. We have been privileged to hear the experience of families who've lost a son, a daughter, a father, a brother, and a husband. And people have given their time very generously to explain their experience with the aim of hopefully preventing other families going through a similar thing in the future, but also to help prison officers and staff who also experience trauma from responding to deaths in prison. So whilst the contribution is very generous, it's really difficult to keep families motivated and to give them confidence that change is happening when the pace of change and improvement is so slow. So I published a progress report in December last year, so that was over a year since the original review was published, and only 3 of the recommendations had been implemented, with another partially complete. So as I sit here today, I can say that that partially complete one has now been implemented, and one more, so we're at a total of 5 recommendations, and we're fast approaching 2 years since that review was actually published. That's not to say there isn't a lot of work going on to try to reach the improvement. The Scottish Prison Service has reviewed its own internal process, and that revised process has actually started just at the end of August this year. The key recommendation working group started a pilot exercise for a revised process as recently as Monday of this week. And you'll remember the key recommendation was about having a separate, a new investigative process, an independent investigation into every death. And actually in Scotland, we already have that. We have an independent process in the form of the Lord Advocate, who is the independent head of investigation for all sudden and suspicious deaths. And every death in prison requires a mandatory fatal accident inquiry. So fatal accident inquiries were out with the terms of reference of the original review and are outside my remit too, but it's been unavoidable when discussing how to improve the response to deaths in prison that people have expressed concerns, concerns with which I agree, that FAIs take far too long and that communication with families is poor. So basically, my opinion is that the key recommendation would not be required with the introduction of yet another process and with more expense. It wouldn't be required if the current FAI process was actually improved in terms of speed and quality of communication with families. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much indeed. I wonder if I can, before I bring in other members, I wonder if I can maybe just start off with a general question about the expectation around timescales. So essentially, there was one key big recommendation, as it were, and a number of other recommendations. So given, you know, the recommendations applied across essentially a system and not just one organisation, was there a kind of expectation of how long it might be considered reasonable for the recommendations to be implemented?
I am not aware of a particular timescale being imposed for implementation. I think it was acknowledged that some of those recommendations are complex and some could reasonably take some time to implement. However, this work started in 2019 and some of the families have been involved since then, and it's 4 years on is a long time for people not to actually see recommendations and improvements made. And some of the recommendations are not really problematic, in my opinion. And I did say that in the December progress report, and you could see from the updates that I've provided that actually when a draft of that progress report went out in November last year, at least two of the recommendations that I said were quite easily implemented were almost immediately then subject to governor's and manager's action notes, so a mandatory instruction from the chief executive of the prison service to make that happen, which is great. However, it does beg the question, why didn't they do that before?
Absolutely. And it's interesting that you talk about some of the recommendations that, in your view, should not have been particularly problematic to implement. Do you have a view on why progress wasn't made with those ones?
It's very difficult to tell where the reluctance comes from. In the various meetings that I've had and the discussions that I've had with people directly in working in the prison service, I think that they do care about this subject. But I think that I have picked up the impression that they don't necessarily agree with the review, that the prison service feels unfairly criticised, and that they are actually doing, working as hard as they can and doing as much as they can in order to prevent deaths in prison, but these tragedies do occur, and that, you know, they will do their best to respond when those situations occur. So I do have this sense that there is some resistance to the findings of the review, that perhaps it's not wholly embraced, that there actually is a need to change.
Thank you. And I know members will look to ask and look more deeply into that. I wonder if I can, and I'm quite keen for our session today to focus on progress in relation to the recommendations, but I wonder if it might be helpful just to step back a bit. And as you said, you know, given the size of the prison population in Scotland, it is inevitable, sadly, that there will be some deaths within the prison estate. I just wondered if it might be helpful for you to outline a little bit of the context of around the sort of experience of prison mortality in prisons. What are the sort of common underlying reasons, for example?
Well, that is a really important element which has been sadly lacking in Scotland in terms of the availability of data and the analysis of data. We were pleased to be able to produce the first of what I hope will be a number of reports just in August this year, which did seek to analyse the deaths between 2012 and 2022. And there are some... it is a reasonable start point for analysis and deeper understanding of the factors that actually contribute to deaths in prison. So as a high level between those years, 2012 and 2022, there were 350 prison deaths. Just under half of those could be attributed to suicide or drug-related deaths, and over half were attributed to illness, disease, natural causes. I do caution about, you know, this acceptance about the number of people succumbing to disease and illness in prison, because I think there needs to be a greater scrutiny on the quality and availability of healthcare available to people in the prison estate, and also the availability of resources, not least in the prison escort capacity, in order to take people out of an establishment and to access appointments and treatment. And that isn't something that this initial report has actually been able to do as yet.
Thanks very much. Okay, I'm going to open up questions to members. I'm going to hand over to Russell Finlay, and then if members could indicate when they'd like to come in. Russell.
Thank you very much, Convener. So just to go back to the kind of chronology of events, the Scottish Government commissioned this report November 2019. And then it reported in November 2021.
Correct.
So that's now almost 2 years. There was 19 recommendations and 6 advisory points. And to be clear, of those 25 in total, almost 2 years later, only 5 have been implemented.
Correct. It's actually 26 if you count the key recommendations. The key recommendation,
right.
19 recommendations, right. And 6 advisory points, and only 5.
5
are
of 26.
Complete.
Right.
Correct.
Okay. So, how do you feel about that? Is it frustration? Is it surprise? Is it what's your thoughts on that?
Frustration, I think, would be a fair description. I don't think I'm surprised. The recommendations, many are shared between the Scottish Prison Service and the National Health Service. In the first case, the Prison Service, I've mentioned there is a system and a hierarchy where the Chief Executive can issue what they call GMAs, so Governors and Managers Action Notes, and that is an instruction with which all governors must comply. So we've talked already about, you know, being puzzled as to why that hasn't been employed more widely, more quickly. As for the NHS, there is a very hard-working network in Scotland, the Prison Care Network, which seeks to improve healthcare provision across the prison estate and seeks to achieve an element of consistency across the establishments. However, that network doesn't have any power to actually make the health boards implement the recommendations that they are proposing. And that is very frustrating and very difficult to see how that's going to improve.
Yeah, thank you. Now, in your opening statement, if I understood it correctly, the key recommendation of the report is that there should be an entirely new system of investigating deaths in custody.
Correct.
But if I understand correctly, you're of the view that that's not necessary if and only the fixed fatal accident inquiry system.
Correct.
For which concerns have been raised for almost a decade. So where's the reluctance coming from? Is that Scottish Government, or is that the Crown Office, or is it both? Is it the blob? I mean, what's the problem with fixing FAI when it's so clearly fundamentally flawed?
I think the only people who don't think there's a problem with fatal accident inquiries are the Crown Office.
Right. So does it take the ministers to start, you know, insisting that the Crown
absolutely
do accept there's a problem and do something about
it? And I think the reticence and the difficulty there is that the Lord Advocate's position is entirely independent, and for that reason the process was deliberately excluded from the terms of reference of the review, and is actually outside, I've said, is outside my remit. What I'm reflecting to you today is the feedback that I've had from families who are affected directly by the system and my own observations.
So, but there's nothing stopping any government from saying to the Crown Office, notwithstanding the Lord Advocate's independence and the Crown's independence, they could impose or create or fix a system without impinging on that independence.
Constitutionally, the Lord Advocate is entirely independent, so it would be very difficult for ministers without a change in legislation to actually impose, say, mandatory timescales or something like that. But okay. I do think that that would help, given that there has been criticism for many years and the problems do continue, and so something needs to change.
Yeah, thank you. And just finally, there's been 350 deaths in custody since 2012, 23 this year alone. You were due to meet the Cabinet Secretary for Health and the Cabinet Secretary for Justice in August. That meeting was cancelled. You were then due to meet them in September. That meeting was cancelled. There's a new meeting scheduled for November.
21st of November.
Yeah. I mean, do you know why these were cancelled? It doesn't suggest to me that there's any great urgency to sit down and work out what needs to happen here.
I've just been told that there was other pressing parliamentary business on both those occasions, but I do think it's disappointing that, you know, even half an hour to draw the Cabinet Secretary's attention. And I was so pleased that it was both, not just the Cabinet Secretary for Justice, but also Cabinet Secretary for Health, because the two are inextricably linked on this topic. There have actually been 26 deaths now this year,
right.
One most recently, sadly, at the weekend, and 19, well, now 20 of those deaths have happened since May. So we've been seeing quite an acceleration during this year.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thanks very much. I'm going to bring in Rona Mackay, followed by Pauline McNeill.
Okay, thank you, convener. Good morning. Just a few things. I'm trying to sort of establish the sort of process of the group, if you like. And you say you feel there's been some reluctance to accept some of the findings of the report. So how often, if at all, did all parties meet round table to discuss issues? And why did you get that impression that there was resistance?
Well, after I was appointed in April last year, I was able to set up a death in prison custody action group. So that's the kind of overarching group with all the stakeholders and various partners present at that group. And underneath that group, there already was a key recommendation working group that the government chair, and that again has all the various partners around the table. I introduced a family reference group, which I've referred to in my opening remarks, and also a further working group to look at the data. Basically, it's called Understanding and Preventing Deaths in Prison Working Group. So the prison service is represented on all of those groups, with the exception of the family reference group, obviously, albeit they have come and presented to the family reference group on a number of occasions about improvements that are underway. Things like the family support booklet, which is actually now published. Things like the means for family members to actually contact a prison and express concerns about their relative in prison, which is not yet complete, which is an example of one of the things I mentioned. There are some things that don't seem to me to be hugely complicated, mm-hmm. nor expensive, and that is one of them. So the partners have all mm-hmm. had ample opportunity to sit mm-hmm. round the table together, mm-hmm. and also every time there is an action group meeting, we seek updates from everybody, you know, the prison service, the NHS, and all the parties. Yeah. And we do have a lot of detail actually on a spreadsheet that is available for public scrutiny.
So how often did those meetings take place on average in a year when you all got together and you had the data and all that?
I'm trying to think about the action group has probably met four times now, but underneath that,
four times this year
since April 2022. Uh-huh.
Right.
Yes, okay. But there are also these working groups uh-huh. underneath and the key recommendation working group. So I would say that, you know, there have been at least a dozen meetings in these various iterations.
So it seems like there's an awful lot of working groups. Is it the case maybe there's a lack of communication? You know, is it the structure of it too layered? You know what I mean? So that people are off in their own silos doing stuff, but nothing's actually getting done. Would that be, and can I ask how you felt as the chair? Was your position, has it been undermined by the delays in all this?
To answer your first point, I don't think there actually is an excuse there in terms of some sort of lack of opportunity to communicate effectively. There's constant communication in terms of seeking progress updates to populate the spreadsheets to say, right, what is actually being done in relation to each of these recommendations. In my position, I feel it is difficult to continue to have credibility when you're not having the impact that you would want to have, that coming into the role, it would seem relatively straightforward that there's already been huge amount of work done by other people, not by me, in order to arrive at a key recommendation, 19 recommendations, six advisory points, all of which have been accepted in principle by the government. So it should be a fairly straightforward task mm-hmm. for me to, as an external person, to oversee the implementation. And it hasn't proved to be the case because it is just very, very slow.
Could you have put any sort of timeline or a deadline in any of these implementations? Would that have been within your remit to do that?
Yes, absolutely, and we did indeed do that exact thing. And I could show you it, but it looks more complicated than it is. But basically, we did indeed arrive at quite a high level action plan with what I'm happy to share with members, and tried to impose deadlines, 0 to 9 months, 9 to 18, 18 to 24, and actually reflected on this in preparation for today. And in that 9 to 18 months, there's only two things that I could put a tentative tick at, and in the 18 to 24 mm-hmm. there's nothing mm-hmm. that I could tick.
Did you get any robust explanations from the groups why it didn't happen? You know, I mean, did it just not happen and nothing was, you know, there was no comeback on that? Or
I think that there are lots of pressures on the system. There's lots of competing priorities particularly in the NHS. I've said and made positive comment about the network. I think that people work very hard in the National Prison Care Network, and indeed that network sits underneath a Scottish health and custody network, and the chairs of both of those are very hardworking and enthusiastic people and have very small teams to support them. I have to say, having tried very hard to get access to NHS chief executives and then ultimately getting time at one of their private chief executive meetings, I have rarely experienced such a lack of interest in a piece of work in all of my 36 years public service.
Okay, thank you. Thanks, convener. Okay, thank you. Opening Polly McNeill, followed by John Swinney.
Thank you very much. Good morning. What you said there is very concerning, with 350 deaths and numerous, numerous cases that members of this Parliament have taken on the death of Alan Marshall, on remand in our care, and Katie Allen, a young woman who took her own life in Pullman. I mean, it's shocking to hear that. When we heard the independent review in response to deaths in prison custody report, all the recommendations seem to be good ones. But it is staggering what you're telling us, is that very few of them have been pursued. There's two in particular I wanted to ask you about. So I've had some involvement with Katie Allen's case. I've met with her family. Now, I understand that they, through Freedom of Information and meetings they had a commitment from the then Cabinet Secretary for Justice on the removal of ligatures from the prison estate, but they are led to believe that it's cost that's preventing this from happening. Is there anything you could comment to the committee on that?
Well, actually, that is one that has been implemented now. That was the one, there was a recommendation that actually suggested the introduction of privacy screens and the availability of ligature cutters. So that was the one in December last year that was partially complete, because the screens had been made available but the ligature cutters hadn't. But by the time, you know, as I'm sitting here today, and I can say that I've been told that ligature cutters are now also have been made available and procured. So that recommendation is actually fully implemented now. I do think there's an issue about who goes in and checks to actually see that the improvement that has been reported is actually in place and that the systems are working. And that's something to which my role doesn't extend. And actually my role will cease at the end of this year anyway. So there needs to be some consideration given to what is the scrutiny mechanism, what is that ongoing monitoring process, and how will people be reassured that actually those improvements, like those very practical things, but fairly straightforward things, have actually been achieved.
Thank you. Well, that's some good news. The second question I wanted to ask you was about the recommendation about unfettered access to information following the death, which I think is critically important, and as the question I asked the Cabinet Secretary at the time. Now, given what you said about the exclusion of the Crown, and in the case of Alan Marshall, which is the one I'm thinking about, well, as you're aware, the Crown took a decision not to prosecute any of the 13 officers who held Alan Marshall down before he died, in an attempt to try and get answers at the FAI, but it took 7 years to get there. What I wanted to press you on was, is it possible, in your view, this unfettered access, is it possible for that to happen? So families want to go in, get that information immediately. You don't want to be told you can't come in, you can't collect belongings, you can't see what happened. I did think it was an interesting recommendation, because I thought of a sudden police investigation around a death. How can you make that, you know, how can you make that commitment? But the Cabinet Secretary did make that commitment. Do you think it's possible to devise a system to allow families? So in this case, their view was it was a cover-up. They would have preferred to go in and find out exactly what happened and at least they would have had their own answers before an FAI. Do you think it's possible to do that without the Crown's involvement?
Short answer, no. I think that the pilot that started, as I said, as recently as this week, is trying to probe exactly those really complex issues about how do you share information without compromising some future process. Obviously, a fatal accident inquiry its purpose is to establish a cause, not to attribute any blame to any party. And if that process were to occur more swiftly with more effective and more sympathetic communication with families, I do think that that would actually achieve some of the aim, certainly of the key recommendation, but also access to information.
And if such a thing could be done, like a timescale of 2 years following the death, which I don't think is unreasonable, perhaps families might feel less concerned about getting that immediate access if they thought they would get answers within 24 months. Do you agree with that?
I completely agree. And what family members have told me is that they do get this feeling that they're somehow the enemy or a risk, or, you know, there's anxiety and fear about telling families what might have happened in case someone is blamed later on. Whereas the families, I've been quite humbled to listen to how concerned they are, not just about their own family and other future families, but about staff as well, about prison officers as well. And they know how traumatic that sympathy for prison officers and staff having to deal with these situations too.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Bring in John Swinney, followed by Sharon Dowie.
Thank you, Kabir. Good morning.
Good morning.
I'd like to follow up where Polly McNeill left off in relation to the interaction between the proposed investigation that would take place and a fatal accident inquiry. And I just wonder if any thought has been given as to whether it is possible to have the type of comprehensive independent investigation that has been proposed here, which I completely understand the rationale for, whilst a fatal accident inquiry is pending. Because, you know, we often rub up against the necessity to leave things until a statutory process, which you quite correctly say has to take place in relation to a death in custody. Has there been any interaction through the group with the Crown about what can be the sequencing of all of this?
Yes, and the Crown has been represented at all of the groups that I've spoken about, but specifically that working group on that implementation of the key recommendation, and have been closely involved in this revised potential process that is being piloted. So there's a pilot exercise which is being led by the Inspectorate for Prisons and will be a desktop exercise looking into cases that are complete, in the sense that these are cases where a fatal accident inquiry has already taken place, but they'll use that set of circumstances in order to test this new process. I mean, I do feel there's already, the prison service has its internal review process, the death in prison learning and audit review, the DIPLAR. The NHS has its internal process, which is a significant adverse event review, SAIR. There's the police investigation that reports, obviously, under the instruction of the Lord Advocate. So the key recommendation is really introducing potentially a fourth investigative process, oblique review. And actually, the key recommendation implies that there should be a new body to carry that out, which, you know, in the current climate, I think would be, you know, quite unrealistic to achieve.
But I think listening to what you've said, and particularly your responses to Polly McNeill about the perspective of families, families quite understandably want to hear early information. I think even the concept of 24 months feels to me to be an awful long time to wait for information.
It's a lot sooner than they get it at the moment.
Well, but it still feels an awful long time. So I just wonder if you could share with the committee the process of scrutiny that's undertaken by the Scottish Prison Service and by the National Health Service. What sort of timescales do they take place under? Are they swifter yes. processes than the FAI?
Yes, they are more. They are much more quickly introduced. But until this review and until the pushing for the implementation of the recommendations of this review, the families sometimes didn't even know that there was a DIPLR taking place and they weren't in any way involved. So now the revised process that has just been brought in last month puts an emphasis on family involvement and actually having a point of contact for families, having a liaison person for families so that they have an opportunity to ask questions about the death of their loved one.
Because that would strike me that if families were able, you know, notwithstanding the issues in relation to the arrangements for a fatal accident inquiry, which are, as you properly say, these are entirely matters for the Crown, mm-hmm. which are carried out independently of Scottish ministers. But I'm interested whether or not a pragmatic adaptation of the processes that are undertaken by the Scottish Prison Service and the Health Service could actually be done timorously so that families would actually get really quite early and prompt and thorough and engaged and courteous engagement about the circumstances of the death of a loved one.
I agree that both of those processes, the Scottish Prison Service's process and the National Health Service process, do hold the potential to meet the needs of families in terms of more prompt answers and a more sympathetic and respectful communication.
If I can move on from that point onto the composition of the Deaths in Prison Custody Action Group, and I'm interested to know, do you feel there is everybody rowing in the same direction?
I think that we've had good representation from the various agencies at that action group.
It's not quite what I'm asking. Is everyone on board?
I think there has been, there's a reticence on the part of, I've said, the prison service in terms of actually genuinely embracing the review and welcoming it and seeing that there really is something that needs to change. I have felt slightly humoured at times, patronised at other times, that I don't understand how difficult it is. It is an absolutely a challenging environment in which to work, and the system is under pressure. But I do keep returning to what I feel is one of the most compelling parts of my duty as to the families of people who've died. And it is very hard to sit in a room with relatives who are bereaved, asking them to give their time, asking them to repeat their experiences over and over again without the actual result that they're looking for, which is improvement for other families, and indeed answers for their own situations. So yes, I've felt at times some people haven't been pulling quite in the same direction, and I do think Crown Office as well do not think that there's a problem with the fatal accident process. And indeed, when I published or put out the draft of the progress report in November last year, the Crown Office immediately came back and asked me to remove the reference to fatal accident inquiries because it's not in my remit and I don't have any business in commenting on it. And I refused to remove it because what I'm doing is doing what I'm doing to you today is reflecting the feedback that I've had. and the observations that I've made as an independent person, which I do think have some validity.
Thank you for that. I wonder if I may have just ask about one other area. I was very struck, Ms. Emery, in your remark about the fact that you were cautious about relying on the data about, if I summarise, I think what you said about 50% of deaths in custody arising out of what one might describe as illness or natural
yes.
causes. And I understand exactly your point on being cautious about that data, because I think it opens up a discussion about the extent to which being incarcerated actually exacerbates the decline in health of individuals,
mm-hmm.
and therefore what must society do to try to address that particular point. And I wonder if I'm correctly understanding the substance behind the point that you're making in that observation.
Absolutely, and I think the lack of scrutiny of the availability and the quality of healthcare across the prison estate is a national disgrace. That there really is very little scrutiny applied to what sort of healthcare is provided to people who already have complex needs. And in the care of the state, people should actually be accessing better healthcare than they ever would in the community, because they are literally a captive audience for health interventions, and that does not appear to be happening.
And has that particular perspective been the subject of discussion around the table of the custody action group, given the fact that you do have the prison service and the National Health Service and Healthcare Improvement Scotland, amongst others, around that table?
It has been discussed, and I've mentioned the network in particular. The National Prison Care Network is very motivated to try to achieve consistency across the prison estate. I do feel the NHS health boards don't necessarily wholly embrace the priority that should be given to members of the community from every health board who could find themselves in prison. So it's not just the health boards where there's a prison physically located within their geographic area. It's, every health board. I think there is the issue that I've already mentioned, where that network, no matter how hard-working and well-meaning, it does not have a mandate to make health boards take on the response and the responsibility for healthcare provision within prisons.
Thank you. Okay, thank you. I'll bring in Sharon Dowie and then Fulton McGregor.
Okay, thank you. You've actually already answered a few of the points that I already had, but can I just check again? You said that 5 of the recommendations had been implemented in your written communication. You'd said that 1 of the recommendations is said to be addressed. So are the 5 of them now fully implemented, or is 1 of them still being addressed?
There are 5. 5 are complete. It may be that I've used a different word.
That's fine. Could I just ask as well, could you tell me what recommendations have actually been completed?
I can, absolutely.
Even just the number point, I do have the numbers here. If you could just tell me the numbers, that would be fine.
Yeah, I can absolutely do that. And because I anticipated that question, and where I've put it in my notes is a different issue.
I can come back to that if it's...
No, it's absolutely fine. So 1.4, which is the next of kin, that's implemented. That was one of the 3 that was in the progress report last year. Mm. 2.2, which was the one I discussed with Ms McNeill about the ligature and the screen provision. 3.1 was about a governor in charge actually being in contact with families, is implemented. 3.3 is the family support booklet, which I've said is implemented. And 5.4, which is for the prison service to conduct that internal, the DIPLR internal review process for all deaths. Okay. That is also implemented, so that's the five.
Okay. Right. Thanks for that. I was going to ask you as well about a plan of action for the rest of the points, and you've already mentioned that, but could I ask, are you aware of a plan of action from the Scottish Prison Service and from the NHS that actually lists a timescale on it for when they think it's going to be implemented, and have they got an accountable person on it as well? So is there somebody that's actually accountable for making sure that that point is actioned?
We have pushed quite hard to get, when I've explained, we've sought updates at every stage. You know, when there's another action group meeting pending, we'd seek an update in order to be able to populate a spreadsheet and make that available publicly to show the various activities that are underway. There are timescales. Those do and have slipped. You'd see that in the briefings that I provided in June this year, and then again in September, just at the start of this month, that certain things were, you know, anticipated would be available. However, you know, those haven't happened until, you know, much later. There are responsible people now identified in every health board for healthcare in prison. We've yet to see that actually manifest in change, but I'm hopeful that that will help, that the network that I've mentioned are at an advanced stage of producing a toolkit to actually achieve some consistency across the prison estate for a response to deaths in prison. And the health boards are obviously pivotal to making that a reality across the country. So we do keep pushing for timescales, but those do tend to slip.
Right. And is there somebody who's being held accountable within those areas, the SPS or NHS? So is there a name that you could write to somebody and say, how are you progressing with point number 3.2?
We do have named people, but there are limitations to the mandate that they have. That's what I was explaining about the National Prison Network. There are named people working hard in that network, but actually they can't make the chief executives implement the recommendations. So the actually, after the progress report was published on the 14th of December last year, the then Cabinet Secretaries for Health and Justice wrote on the 18th of December to the Chief Executive of the Prison Service and all the NHS Chief Execs and told them to prioritise this work. But unfortunately, I don't think that has quite had the effect that it was hoped.
Moved it forward. Right. I wanted to ask you about that as well. It was already mentioned by Russell Finlay on the meetings that were cancelled. Mm-hmm. One of the other things that I noted in your submission was that you're due to finish in November as well. So can I ask how many meetings have you actually had with the Cabinet Secretary since you took your post?
One.
So one. And was that with both Cabinet Secretaries or was that just one?
With both in November last year.
So that was last year?
Mm-hmm.
And so have you had any written communication with them in between times or?
Other than the progress report in December, no.
There's not been any meeting. Right, and what happens with your post then in November? Will you be kept on or does that finish or have you had any communication in that at all?
No, I think, well, I've certainly agreed to stay until the end of the year, so I'll have time to produce another, what I would call final report, but it'll only be final in the sense that it's the last report from me. It won't be final in the sense that all the recommendations will be complete. I'm pretty sure. I think the rationale for bringing someone external in was to try to give impetus to implement these recommendations, and I think it's difficult to justify keeping someone in that capacity on beyond 2 years after a report has been published.
So what do you think is going to happen after the... Because you've obviously said there's been slow progress in the last 2 years, so, and you're obviously trying to keep pushing this on, so what do you think is going to happen after you leave?
Well, my biggest concern is for those family representatives who have given their time and gone through that kind of triggering process of not just telling their own stories but listening to other families' experiences, and feeling that I've let them down, because I won't be able to look them in the eye and say, I came in to do this and I've done it. I think the responsibility then falls to the statutory bodies, so most obviously the Inspectorate for Prisons. Again, there's a limited resource at the Inspectorate in order to drive the scrutiny. I've spoken to other groups like the National Preventive Mechanism, that's a sort of network of scrutiny bodies for people in deprived of their liberty, to raise that question with them, actually. You know, do they feel they have some capacity to monitor and keep some pressure on to implement these recommendations? Healthcare Improvement Scotland, I think, should be looking much more regularly at the quality and availability of healthcare in prisons. They do participate in the inspections, the joint inspections that are led by the prison inspectorate, but those are only two or three establishments a year.
Right. So I'll just go back. So nobody spoke to you about extending your term. You don't know about anybody else that's coming in. What do you think needs to happen to try and get more pace to get the implementations?
I think that absolutely there needs to be continued scrutiny, and somebody needs to be driving the activity. I'm not sure, having done it since April last year, I'm not sure that bringing in another external chair will make any difference.
Okay.
Thank you very much. I'll pass over to Philip McGregor and then bring in Russell Finlay.
No, good morning. I'll just follow on from where Sharon Dowie was there. I think we can all hear today the passion in your voice for this piece of work, and I think it's probably prompted by your time coming to an end, and perhaps it's not as complete as you would like, and I think that's probably an understatement. And in many ways, I'm going to put words into your mouth here, and maybe you know it's maybe a bit extreme, but almost feels today, coming to committee and contacting the committee, that it's a wee bit of a cry for help in terms of this piece of work. What do you feel this committee can do to help progress the recommendations that you're making? Because you've made it very powerfully today.
Thank you. I think if you had the time to invite some of the people responsible for actually delivering on the recommendations to come and speak, that would be helpful, that then there would be actual direct exchange about, well, what is it that's making this so difficult to achieve? You know, the recommendations are, you know, obviously there are many not implemented yet, but there's, in total, it's not insurmountable. It's 20 things and 6 advisory points that I think, you know, as a country, we should be capable of achieving for people that are literally without power, imprisoned in our country's prison estate.
Okay, thank you for that. I think you've certainly given us a lot of food for thought when we come to discussing what we've heard today. There was two other wee points I wanted to ask about. They're not wee points in terms of the evidence session, but they're not wee and small in any means. And it's around about, I think John Swinney was asking about it as well, it's around about the deaths. And across the period of the pandemic, there was an increase. Did you ever get any information, or was there ever any information released through this bit of work about what was causing those? Was it related to the pandemic, either the virus itself or the restrictions? But did you ever get a feel for that?
No, I didn't. Other than the fact of the number of deaths peaking at 53 for, I think that was 2021. So there was a noticeable increase. But no, I haven't had any further analytical work to establish what that was about. But as I've said earlier, I do feel that the report that was published in August is just a start point, that there should then be more analysis carried out into the deaths and into, you know, comparing the trends with trends in the general population, and all with a view to trying to understand factors so that there can be some prevention intervention to reduce deaths in the future.
Thanks for that. And on a similar point, then you mentioned at one point there'd been an increase over the summer, I think, since May.
Yes.
Again, is there any data or analysis around that, why that's taken place?
No, there isn't. But obviously you will have heard about pressures in the system and increases in the prison population. So it'll be interesting to see what the factors are. But it is concerning that the level of deaths is increasing over time.
OK, thanks very much for your evidence.
Yeah, thank you. Russell Finlay.
Thanks very much. Two very quick questions. First of all, the Scottish Government will be watching this evidence. They'll have read your submissions. Would you consider, if it was at all possible, extending your tenure for, say, a 12-month period? Or are you completely scunnered and you've had enough? is that an option?
I would be willing to continue to try to help if I can, but I would temper that enthusiasm with reality of how much I've actually managed to achieve so far. So I wouldn't say no.
Right, okay, thank you. Now, just come back to the fundamentals. The fatal accident inquiry system is central to deaths in custody. But the review, and you were told you couldn't even look at this, and you quite rightly said, well, that's ridiculous, and you did look at it. Uniquely, the Crown Office seemed to think fatal accident inquiries are fine despite the abundance of evidence of all the misery and pain that they're causing in addition to the deaths that have occurred. So given the reluctance to, or the inability to fix FAI, we are therefore left with the key recommendation, the one that you would rather not see enacted. But that surely is the direction of travel, and at some point may or may not be enacted. Do you know if there's been any work done around the cost of this in setting up a whole new organisation that would deal specifically with deaths in custody? Is there any work, any discussions?
Not to my knowledge. But I obviously was very aware, looking at that and how it might coexist with the three existing processes, how much more pressure it would put on the public purse, as well as the inherent difficulties of asking people, families, but also prison officers, staff, to comply with potentially four processes, not just three.
Yeah, okay, thank you very much. Thank you.
Can I just follow up the point that Russell Finlay has just been advancing there, which is in relation to the adequacy of the immediate SBS review and the immediate health service review of a death in custody. Because I understand, obviously, by statute, the requirement of a fatal accident inquiry to be undertaken where somebody is in legal custody. But from the perspective of addressing the needs of the families that you've powerfully put to us this morning, Ms. Emery, what do you believe those processes, I'm not sure if you're familiar with the content of those processes, but if you are, do you believe those would provide a sufficient amount of information in advance of a fatal accident inquiry, which would essentially avoid the need for there to be a potentially fourth process that gets added onto the system?
I think they could, and I think that is the revised process that I've mentioned has just started at the end of August this year, that there was one of these instructions that was issued for all governors in all establishments in Scotland to introduce the revised DIPLR process, and that does prioritise liaison with families. So I understand that that will be evaluated and will be reviewed in February next year, so it will have had an opportunity to be tried in real time, and it would be obviously a great improvement if that delivers what it's hoped to deliver. On the NHS side, that was the toolkit that I mentioned, that the network is at an advanced stage of providing that national guidance for how SAER, the Serious Adverse Event Review, be carried out in response to a death in prison. And the issue there is to ensure that all the NHS boards actually implement this toolkit, as they're calling it. And hopefully the fact that the boards have actually now got an executive lead in every health board for prison care, that will help ensure that toolkit is implemented. So those two parts should improve and enhance the existing internal processes of review for both the prison service and the NHS. Whether that culminates, in something that negates, I certainly wouldn't say it negates improvement, the need for improvement in the FEI process. I think that is absolutely required also.
And just lastly, do you think that the improvements you've talked about there on those two processes, do they provide you with sufficient confidence in theory that they would substantively address some of the early issues that families may have in the absence of a fatal accident inquiry being able to be undertaken in a really timeous fashion?
Yes, in theory, they do give me confidence. I mean, all the families really want is a few answers to perfectly reasonable questions about what has happened to their loved one in prison. That's all they want.
I understand that. Okay. Thank you very much, Father. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, I think we're just about up to time. I was just wanting to pick up, sort of staying with the key recommendation around the an additional sort of independent review process, and a note in the review report, the context particularly around the needs of families, which we've discussed quite robustly this morning. But I noticed in the review there was reference to the fact that this change, i.e. creating another independent process, would bring Scotland into line with practice in other jurisdictions, including England, Wales and Northern Ireland. Now, I know it's not just a case of taking a model from somewhere else and slotting it into our policies and processes, but I just wondered if there was any work done to look at those processes, and if there were, if there was a feeling that there was good learning from those processes that could realistically form part of a new process in Scotland, bearing in mind what we've been discussing today about the other option potentially of looking at the processes that exist already and perhaps making some changes there.
Yes, there has been work carried out by the government to engage with the relevant people in other jurisdictions to understand the approach and to try and take the good practice and any learning from elsewhere to bring to bear on the review of processes here. Yes, absolutely. There is an interest in and have been efforts to look at the approaches elsewhere. Obviously, the big difference in Scotland is the role of the Lord Advocate.
Indeed. And just one final, really just more a comment about the kind of the feelings of families as things stand at the moment in respect of the slow pace of implementation of the recommendations. You know, you clearly have close contact with families. What do they feel about where we are now?
Well, I think that they are disappointed and frustrated at the lack of real change that some of these families have been involved since the review was commissioned in 2019. So it's nearly 4 years and not much has changed. I think that they have been remarkably resilient in continuing to attend the various meetings, and they actually, representatives from the families, attend every one of the groups that I've mentioned, really because when I started, there was so little trust on the part of the families in what they were being told, that they really wanted to have someone in the room at every meeting of every group, and they have that. And I think they're encouraged that, to some extent, that the committee's interested and wants to hear more about this. But they really would rather, obviously, in their individual cases, want to have answers to their questions. Mm-hmm. But more generally, they really want to see improvements for other families in the future and to prevent future deaths.
Yep. Thank you. Okay, I'm going to bring this session to a close. Can I thank you very much indeed for attending this morning? And we'll just take a short suspension to allow us to have a comfort break and to allow Ms. Emery to leave. Thank you.
Thank you, convener. Thank you, everyone, for your interest. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Our next item of business is to review the Scottish Government's response to our post-legislative inquiry on the Domestic Abuse Scotland Act of 2018, and I refer members to paper number 3. And I'm just going to invite members to come in with any comments or points that they would like to make on the Scottish Government's response or any suggestions for further follow-up. So are there any points that members... Russell?
Thank you. That siren has passed. a few points. One of them, I think perhaps one of the most important ones, relates to the statutory aggravator of involvement of a child in a domestic incident. And our report, which was made, I think, 8 separate recommendations, that was perhaps key. The response, and essentially what I think we said, is that it's not really being measured or used, or it's not clear how well it's being used, because we don't really know. It's hard to work out the detail. It's not entirely clear how it's being used. But I think the response to that point we made in the report is a little bit vague. It talks in, I would suggest, generalities. It doesn't really say, you know, what exactly the government is doing to address that. The second point relates to communication to the public. So our report also made a recommendation that there was previously quite an effective public awareness campaign, and suggesting that something similar could be done again, because people maybe don't realise what this legislation does. And again, the response from the minister appears to be slightly, I think the word they've used again is vague, you know, that there's consideration of a campaign to address these issues. So just nice to know if there's something actually material in respect of both those points.
Okay, thank you. And I think in relation to the aggravator, that would be clearly be an operational issue, and one where it's at the officer's discretion whether it's appropriate to include it. But yes, I've noted that, and I think my recollection is that we were quite keen for there to be something explored in and around a public awareness campaign, due to some previous indications that it's quite an effective piece of work to undertake.
Just come back to the aggravator point. Yeah. The Minister says that they'll publish more detailed statistical information at some point, I think they say, later this year. So it'll be nice to know when that is. And
so we can,
because there's the evidence we took in the report, there's quite a lot of evidence from witnesses saying that this hasn't been getting used properly. It's not clear when and how it's been used.
Yeah.
It's hard to assess how well it's been used, because we can't get the frustration was they couldn't get the data. So it would be nice to pin them down a bit more, I think, on that.
Yeah. So. Okay. I mean, I'm happy to just go back and stress that we'd be keen in particular to ensure that particular issue is incorporated into the report.
Thank you.
Okay. Anyone else want to come in? Rona Mackay. Sorry, beg your pardon. I'll bring in Rona and then Pauline.
Okay. Thanks, Convener. I've not had a chance to read the Domestic Abuse and Stalking Charges report that was published on the 12th of September, but I look forward to that. I think that will probably throw up a lot of information. I'm just not clear in the main findings whether there are statistics for the coercive element of the bill. I'm not sure if the statistics used include that in the new statutory offence, engaging in coercive behaviour, which is abusive of a partner or ex-partner. It might be, that might be coercive, but it doesn't state that. So I'd quite like to know that. And I was interested in the stalking charges, that 921 stalking charges were reported to the Crown Office, and of these, 485 were identified as domestic abuse. So those are really useful statistics to have. But as I say, once I read the full report, I'll be better informed. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. Pauline McNeill.
Thank you. I mean, just following on from Rona, I'd be interested to spend more time looking at the stalking charges, it's obviously broader than domestic abuse, and I think there are some issues with victims certainly reporting some failures in the system in relation to the law there, but for another day. From the paper, are we to assume that under item 3, these changes have already happened or have already been agreed? That list of creating standard conditions of bail, placing a restriction on granting bail, allowing certain evidence, that these already have been... As it says, then it created an offence of engaging in abusive conduct. For example, where a child sees here is present during domestic abuse incident, that's what Russell had raised. Further changes included. So we to assume this has all happened.
Is that paragraph 3 in the paper?
Yes.
Yeah.
I would need to check for you, Ms McNeill. I mean, the bill or the Act was passed in 2018. I'm not aware that there are provisions in that Act that are not yet enforced, but I'll clarify that.
Yeah, that's what I thought.
I believe they're enforced, but I would need to clarify that.
Yeah, because I thought... So the top ones, I think, would require further discussion if they haven't been implemented. I would have said, but the bottom three, applying certain special measures aimed at protecting child witnesses, requiring the court to consider future protection of victim when sentencing an offender. The bottom one, I think, is really important, telling the court to always consider making a non-harassment order against a person convicted of a domestic abuse offence is really important, because otherwise, many cases up till now, they've had to seek privately, either under one of the interdict civil processes, which is costly for most people. It would be helpful to clarify if these are just recommendations or not. Thank you, Convener.
No, that's fine. We can check that. Any other comments? No. Sharon Dowie.
The only kind of comments that I'd put all the way right down was when, because there's a lot of, in the Scottish Government response, there's a lot of actions, but there isn't any dates or anything when it's going to be achieved. So it's later this year, and then we will reconvene. Inform future consideration of a campaign to address these additions, but there's no dates on when anything's going to happen, so I'd be interested to see that. So is a report later this year going to be the 31st of December, or can we expect it before that? The only other thing, and again, I'm just new in, but some of the thing about sentencing as well. So from an outsider looking in, a lot of the issues in the press seem to be about sentencing, so I don't know if there's anything getting done along with the Sentencing Council. Just on sentences that are being given out, and I know there's the under 25s, etc., but that was one of the things that I'd put down as well. Yeah. But looking at sentencing.
Okay, thanks. I think you're right, there's not a specific date been included in the response, but my interpretation of the update in relation to a final report later this year would be by the end of this year. But we can monitor that, obviously. In relation to the issue around the Sentencing Council, obviously they are independent, and so I think the again, it's more about looking at sort of tracking the policy around sentencing in relation to domestic abuse and violence against women. So I think I assume that will be included in the further response that we get. Okay. Russell Finlay.
Sorry, just very quickly. The recommendation in our report, which is numbered 89, it was after taking evidence about how some particular domestic abuse cases in the criminal courts, there's civil cases running in tandem, and often an abuser will use one or the other to continue the abuse. Our recommendation was there should be, ask the government to look at or consider or come back with a view on a sort of single sheriff model where there are civil and criminal cases operating simultaneously. And I think the response from the Cabinet Secretary is not really satisfactory. It talks very generally about joined up thinking. It uses the dreaded phrase, a series of workshops. It doesn't say whether they agree or disagree with this, even in principle, and doesn't give any indication as to what is going to happen next, if anything. So, I mean, it talks about the response ends talking about child contact centres, which is a completely different subject. It looks like padding. So, yeah.
Okay. Thanks for that point. I mean, I think I do remember we raised this, and it was a valid point to raise. It's potentially quite a big piece of work to undertake. But you know, if we can ask some further questions on that, because I think it's a valid point to make.
I mean, you know, maybe the government don't want to go down this road. Maybe there's no plans to do so, but in which case, just tell us that, you know.
Yeah.
But it's,
okay,
yeah.
Thank you very much. Any other points at all? No? Okay, so we can certainly go back to, just to sort of summarise, can go back to the Scottish Government for a wee bit more detail in and around the points that you have been raised this morning. And one other option might be to reach out to some of the witnesses that we engaged with during that piece of work, just to seek any further updates or reflections that they might have on progress. Members happy with that? Okay, thank you very much. Okay, our final item this morning in public is consideration of a letter from the Minister for Community Safety on the issue of the misuse of pyrotechnic devices at football and other events. Members will recall that we wrote to the Minister asking whether the police can prevent someone detained after being found with such a device from simply going into the ground once they are released after a search. And we also asked whether football banning orders can be used. So the Minister has replied on both points, and her letter is set out in paper 4. I'm pleased that we raised this, as we've obviously highlighted an issue which the Scottish Government has indicated that it's now considering in relation to how to resolve. So I'm just going to open it up and again ask members for any comments. And if you agree with my suggestion that we now give the Scottish Government a bit of time just to come back to us with a further response and any plans in that regard. So just open it up to members.
Maybe this is clear, but I don't know if we know, and indeed more importantly the public know, what exactly the timeline of implementation is going to be, because the legislation was brought in quite quickly on the basis of needing to address the proxy purchasing for under 18s, and the expected timeline has already been put back in relation to firework control zones, licensing and so on. There was a suggestion, I think, in the letter from the Minister that it was still the government's intent to bring in a key part of this year. Where are we? I think it was relating to firework control zones, but it seems pretty unlikely that that's going to happen. If we don't know anything about which local authorities have a look at who's doing what, how it looks, and so are we up to speed on timeline? And forgive me if I don't know that.
I mean, obviously, your question is about the sort of broader issue of the implementation of the legislation, and we do know that there have been challenges and delays in terms of timescales. I do understand that the Minister is aware that we maintain an interest in that and has undertaken to keep the committee informed specifically about the issues that you've raised around the likes of firework control zones, the licensing scheme. And I know members are very interested in that. But I think for today, what I'm interested in is just ensuring that members are content with the response that we've received in and around the specific points that we raised in connection with football banning orders and the actions of an individual on release from being detained by police if they've been found in possession of a pyrotechnic. So I'm quite keen to just maintain that focus, but I do absolutely understand the points you've made, which I think are reflected across the room. Pauline, I think you wanted to come in. Did you?
Yeah, I mean, when I read the letter, I mean, it goes back to an issue the committee raised previously, which was it felt really rushed. And now I'm actually wondering, you know, it should have been clear what the relationship between football banning orders and this. I mean, far be it from me to say, but surely the role of lawyers and government officials is to match up legislation when they're drafting it in relation to all other pre-existing legislation and work out that it's an obvious relationship, and we are now asking questions in hindsight, and the ministers have to ask that question. And whilst she's quite correct to say it's a matter for the courts, it's a matter for Parliament to determine what they wanted when they legislated. And I would have thought, to a party and to a person, what we wanted was to give maximum powers to arrest people for the use of pyrotechnics going to football matches, which are extremely disruptive. And now we're having to try and fix this in hindsight. So I think the committee probably should have been drawn to attention from the beginning that there's, I mean, it wouldn't have occurred to me that there's a 2000 pre-existing act they might have a relationship with. So,
any comment? Okay, thanks. I mean, I can't obviously speak on behalf of the government in relation to the sort of preparation process for the bill, but I absolutely acknowledge your point. I suppose I'm pleased that we've now highlighted it and there's some work underway on that. Rona Mackay, did you want to come in?
No, I'm happy.
Okay. Anyone else? Sharon Dowie.
Just a question on the, probably kind of follows on for Pauline's. It's on the repeated convictions for possession of pyrotechnic articles. I was just wondering what the penalty for that would end up being. Looking at the under 4.2 of the Fireworks and Pyrotechnics Article Scotland Act 2022, a person who commits an offence who's found with fireworks on them without a licence is liable to imprisonment for a term not exceeding 6 months. But I'm just wondering if that's the same penalty, but then we've got the presumption for not having sentences less than 12 months. So is that actually relevant?
I can't answer that off the top
of
my head.
I was just a question to ask.
Look into that.
Yeah, we can look at that. Not able to answer that off the top of my head, but yeah, I'm happy that we take that away as a wee point of action. Okay, if there's no more questions, are members content that we give the government just a wee bit of time just to come back with to us by way of follow-up? Okay, thank you very much. So that concludes our business in public. This week. Next week, we'll be starting our Stage 1 evidence on the Victims, Witnesses and Justice Reform Bill, and we'll hear from the Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Home Affairs. And we'll now move into private session. Thank you.